Good morning, and welcome to the Unitarian Universalist Community Church of Santa Monica. My name is Cassie Winters, and I am your worship associate for the morning. Today, Michael will be talking deeply with us about what matters. Preparing to write this call to worship, I had to sit and really put words into what matters to me. I'm not one for big gestures of love, kindness, or celebration. Not in the giving, nor in the receiving. Just over 10 years ago, this man that I was working with gifted me with a book called The Power of Small by Linda Kaplan Thaler, who is, among other things, the CEO and president of Kaplan Thaler Productions, a very successful advertising agency. Among numerous awards and accolades, including Girl Scouts Woman of Distinction, you might recognize her work from The Affleck Duck, I Don't Want to Grow Up, I Want to Be a Toys R Us Kid, and Kodak Moments. The book itself tells many stories about how kind gestures, conversations, paying attention to others, and to details has had some tremendous positive outcomes for the people in those stories. The premise being that if you could just work on doing these things too, something positive is bound to happen to you too. I was so touched by what he wrote inside. He said, "You possess unique insight into those little things that truly do go a long way. I will always remember and be thankful for the way you befriended me when I first came to Vista. You made me feel that I belonged in a place that was unlike any other I had ever experienced. May you continue to share your many gifts, both small and large, with every life you touch." Thaler wrote, "In the process of ignoring the utterly useless and insignificant, we have given short shrift to something that is extraordinarily essential. The small gestures, words, and daily kindnesses that speak volumes about our attention to detail and our commitment and concern to affect change and make a difference. This is what matters to me." When coming home from our camping trip for my 50th birthday last week, my partner Kim asked me what one of my favorite memories from the trip was. I think she was a little surprised by my answer. I said that it was when we were creek walking in the Big Sur River, and I was watching her walk and talk with one of the kids that was camping with us, because I just knew that she was talking to him in such a kind way that would help him understand and take a different perspective on some of his struggles. And it is precisely these moments in life that matter to me. As we come together in community in this virtual space, we are very aware of all of which we have had to let go, not the least of which, at the most basic level, coming into physical presence with one another. As we light our own candles, if we choose, to represent the chalice of our community, we are mindful of this sacred time of coming together on our shared journey of discovery. Discovery of what is indestructible within us.
It's not how long we held each other's hand. What matters is how well we loved each other. It's not how far we traveled on our way, but what we found to say. It's not the springs we've seen, but all the shades of green. It's not how long I held you in my arms. What matters is how sweet the years together. It's not how many summer times we had to give to fall. The early morning smiles we wistfully recall. What matters most is that we loved at all. It's not how many summer times we had to give to fall. The laughter and the tears we gratefully recall. What matters most is that we love.
Our minister, the Reverend Jeremiah Calendea, is taking a well-deserved summer break. This morning, our virtual pulpit is occupied by Michael Eselun, who serves as the chaplain for Sims Mann UCLA Center for Integrative Oncology. The two-time TEDx speaker Michael speaks extensively to healthcare professionals, patient populations, and faith communities across the country. He's also worked as an activist and educator addressing anti-LGBTQ bias in the larger community for over 30 years. Michael was recently inducted into the UCLA Semmel Institute Eudaimonia Society in recognition of having lived a meaning-driven life. We are so very fortunate to have the benefit of Michael's wisdom, insight, and compassion. A lot of people who contribute to this service. Our multi-talented director of music, Sandra Choi, directs and produces all of the music in the service and also edits the entire service. The remarkable Ryan Humphrey provides instrumental music. This week, amazing section leader Michael Miersma provides vocal music. Cleo Anderson is our wise director of religious exploration and will be telling the story for all ages. Pam Teplitz and Liz Fuller produce the slides and make sure we are online and on time and that we stay online without a lot of technical glitches. Sunday worship is the heart of how we come together as a faith community. Worship at the Unitarian Universalist Community Church of Santa Monica is led by a diverse team of clergy, professionals, and volunteers. If you have ever imagined yourself in the pulpit as a worship associate, now is the time to let someone know. One of the parts of this community that I have always loved is small group ministry. It's a chance to really get to know each other on a deeper level. We meet monthly, and as a team, we have learned to speak, write, and honor the many identities and spiritual traditions represented in our congregation. And in the past 6 months, we have learned to do all of this remotely. Even with all of the work involved, the people I share the work with is truly what is the most important to me. We are seeking a few more people who would like to join us. You will be trained and supported and you will be welcomed into a team of loving, generous people who work to make our services meaningful. If this is something you think you might like to try, please contact Associate Chairperson, the Reverend Dr. Kikanza Nuri Robbins, to discuss any questions you may have. We have a lot to share this morning. As a community, we know that there are many spoken and unspoken joys, concerns, and life transitions. Today, let us hold in the light and love all those who are carrying the heavy load of life transitions and all that that entails. Please know that we love you. I have the great pleasure of sharing the news of the birth of Dante Philip Donnell on Monday. Dante was born to Alyssa and Chris Donnell, making Greg Wood and Linda Van Lichten first-time grandparents. Alyssa Wood Donnell grew up in our church, and we would like to again offer her our congratulations to both her and Chris, to Greg and Linda, and to welcome Dante Philip. Alyssa, Chris, and Dante will be staying with Linda and Greg for now, so if you'd like to send cards of congratulations, you can get their address from the directory. And we encourage you to reach out to Haigo Sally Beyond, wife of Bill Blake. Bill died unexpectedly a couple of weeks ago. We remember Bill for his contributions to small group ministries here, especially the meditation group that he led. Haigo would like our community to know that the memorial service for Bill Blake will be on September 12th at 12:30. Zoom link will be available a few days before the service. Meanwhile, we hold them in our hearts. In yet another life transition, I'm sad to report that Len Harris died 2 weeks ago. We appreciate all of the time, energy, and wisdom he has brought to the church. We hold in the light our beloved Minister Emeritus, the Reverend Ernie Pipes, still vital in his 90s. We encourage you to send him a note. Let him know that in our isolation, we remember him. Our Unitarian Universalist tradition is not bound by creed, but rather by covenant. Our agreement to meet each other with humility and respect, and in seeking the bonds of love, we walk together. We affirm the worth and dignity of every person. We invite all into a free and responsible search for meaning and direction. We honor the wonder and existence, and we believe that we are all connected to one another and to the interdependent web of life. Our tradition arises from scripture and science, nature and philosophy, personal experience, and ancient traditions. Ours is a welcoming community, inclusive of people of all gender identities, sexual orientations, races, spiritualities, ethnicities, and social locations. We are united in our advocacy for social justice, and we invite you to join us in co-creating this beloved community we share with each other and in the larger world. May you find comfort, camaraderie, and inspiration here. We are so glad to have you with us here this morning. Please join me in reciting our covenant and then singing our hymn of praise. Love is the doctrine of this church. The quest for truth is its sacrament, and service is its prayer. To dwell together in peace, to seek knowledge in freedom, to serve humankind in fellowship, thus do we covenant with each other.
Peace, goodwill on earth. Good morning. I am back this week with another conversation. So as the summer has gone along and come to an end, and as quarantine seems to be stretching out further and further, you've probably heard about things that matter, right? Lots of adults. Black Lives Matter. Voting matters. Protecting everyone matters. The economy matters. And those are all things that matter. But they all seem really big, don't they? These huge, expansive ideas of things that matter. Well, I want to talk about smaller things that matter. Or maybe not smaller, but less grand and front page newsworthy matter. If you're going back to school, take the time to decide what matters. Does your workspace being immaculate matter? In school, does it really matter to you how you're getting your information? Is it easier if you're tapping your fingers, or doodling, or playing with a Rubik's Cube, or does it really matter that you are still and listening and the room is quiet? Holidays are coming up. You've kind of got to figure out in the new normal what matters. Does it really matter that you're physically with your family and friends, or does it matter that you all still get together on video and open presents, or does it matter that everyone's not together to have, you know, coquito like grandma makes it, or does it matter that you all make it separately and enjoy it together over the phone? Does it matter that you can't go Christmas caroling, or does it matter that you sing with your family, or does it matter that you start up a whole sing-along on your block? So this year starts out, and fall comes along, and lots of people are yelling about these big, big things that matter. Look around your life. Decide what matters to you. Does it matter what church looks like to you? Does it matter that you won't be in the same room as all of your friends every Sunday? Or does it matter that you're all moving towards something together, that you're all creating? Does it matter that coffee hour doesn't mean being slid extra cookies behind your parents' back? Or does it matter to pop into coffee hour and say hi to the lovely ladies who were slipping you those cookies for so many years? So again, while the world is big and screaming about things that matter, look around your life. Ask yourself, what matters to you?
Oh, we give thanks for this precious day. For all gathered here and those far away, for this time we share with love and care. Oh, we give thanks for this precious day. Oh, we give thanks for this precious day, for all gathered here and those far away, for this time we share with love and care. Oh, we give thanks for this precious day.
I invite us to close our eyes and get comfortable in our seats as we move into this time of silent reflection and contemplation. As we breathe a few nice deep breaths together, we quiet our minds. We let go of the concerns of the day, the week behind us, and the week ahead of us, and we simply follow the empty breath. We come back to that image of that place within us, the part of us which just may be indestructible. Whatever that place, that essence is, we don't need to give it words. We simply breathe into it, that core of our being. From that place, we move into silence, in community. Good morning. As a reading this morning, I would like to share an excerpt from the Los Angeles Times, dated March 11, 2012. It's a reflection from Mike Nichols, the well-known American film theater director, producer, actor, and comedian, as he was embarking upon directing a revival of Death of a Salesman on Broadway, starring Philip Seymour Hoffman. It is Willie Loman's singular tragedy that he can't understand that true success, says Nichols, is simply the ability to change. Willie can't understand the joy of changing yourself, even by a millimeter. Even if you get 5 millimeters of difference in your life, not bad, he says. His eyes behind stern, dark-rimmed glasses suddenly moisten. I don't like to talk about my kids, but their ability to learn and adjust and change moves me more than I can say. It's the one characteristic you want for them. Learn. Do something else. Change. In Death of a Salesman, the diamond shining in the dark, hard and rough, turns out to be death itself. While Nichols once said, "Get the world to revolve around you and you think you're never going to die," he says that he has no such illusions. Oh my God, if I know anything, I know I'm gonna die. I never forget that. I know I'll be forgotten in a minute, and that's just fine with me. He tells the story of watching the film Elizabeth one night when he couldn't sleep. He was stunned by how good the Cate Blanchett movie was and how gutsy its heroine, Queen Elizabeth I. The next morning, over breakfast, he told Sawyer about the movie, how Elizabeth stood up to the Pope, killed all her enemies at the same time, just like in The Godfather, and was not only right, but right forever. And recalls Nichols, "Diane said one of the greatest things she ever said to me, if forever matters." As Death of a Salesman points out, it is the love or damage that a spouse and parent leaves behind in the here and now that ultimately matters. Everything else is a delusion, says Nichols, and that's what I'd like on my tombstone, if forever matters. In this time of the pandemic, all of us, it seems, are deluged with dozens of unanswerable questions, each one competing for our limited attention and capacity to focus. How long is this going to last? How are we going to make it financially? How do I keep myself safe? How do we live with this kind of uncertainty? As we vacillate between one question or another, whichever happens to be working us over at any particular moment, there might in fact be one question that lies beneath all the others. What matters? As you know, I serve as the chaplain at the Sims Mann UCLA Center for Integrative Oncology. And last fall, as a part of the UCLA Centennial, I was invited on behalf of the UCLA Department of Arts and Architecture to be a presenter at their special 10 Questions event, the Centennial Edition. It was a series of 10 evenings, each one devoted to one particular question for our life and times, each one to be explored by a multidisciplinary panel. When I told my husband, Scott, about the honor of having been invited, he, of course, asked me, "What's your question?" "What matters?" I said. "Oh," he said, "everything and nothing," and then he left the room. Pithy, yes, but also kind of true in a way. Everything matters and nothing matters. Our own individual lives, such as they are in this very moment, are in fact a culmination of countless decisions and choices we've made over the course of our lives, both large and small, each one informed, shaped by our sense of what matters. Do I marry this person or not? Do I live in this city or not? Do I pursue this career or not? Or on a whole other scale, do I buy this pair of shoes or save my money? Do I eat that last piece of chocolate cake or let it pass me by? Each decision is shaped by our sense of what matters. On a national scale, we only have to look less than a year ago at our own Democratic national primary debates to get a cross-section of what matters. Day one of my presidency will be addressing healthcare reform. Day one for me is looking at climate change. Day one for me is cleaning up the corruption in Washington or the catastrophe happening at our southern border. And it all matters. But look at what has happened in the span of less than a year. In just very few months, really, all of that has been trumped, you should pardon the expression, by the COVID-19 pandemic. Does that mean all of that doesn't matter anymore? Of course not. It just means that this matters more right now. This captures our attention. But on a whole other scale, do you know what else matters? That you get home safely from your next outing to the supermarket, or that we have enough cat food that Rupert's been fed, or that I have milk for my oatmeal tomorrow morning. I think what matters ultimately is the thing right in front of us, this very moment. I remember in the early 80s reading a magazine interview with Rosalind Carter. This would have been not long after she and Jimmy had moved out of the White House back to their home in Plains, Georgia. At the time of the interview, I remember she was busily engaged in laying a new brick pathway up to the front stoop of their house. She commented to the interviewer with some amazement to reflect that just very few months earlier, she and Jimmy had been living in the White House, hosting state dinners, Camp David Peace Accord, all of that. And now, the most important thing in the world is that this brick is straight. "And it matters," she said. "Though I was such a young man, I was so struck by the profundity of that, so much so that it still sticks with me 40 years later. It's kind of zen-like, isn't it?" Around the same time, I remember taking some kind of self-development seminar or another. After all, it was the 80s, in which we were given the task of writing our own epitaph. Now, if you've never tried that task, it can be daunting, but also illuminating. It becomes even more daunting when we have to do it for real. My mom died a year ago, last April. You know, there's only so much room on those little bronze plaques, only room for very few words. Which few words are you going to choose to summarize, to encapsulate an entire human life? What I chose for myself in my 20s was, he was moved by life. I think what matters is really quite fluid and changeable over the course of a lifetime, maybe even over the course of an afternoon. What mattered to me at 25 is not what mattered to me at 45, which bears little resemblance to what matters to me today at 65. I think in the first half of life, we are so focused on achieving our goals, accomplishing something, achieving success, as if we have the vaguest idea what that really means. Second half of life is a little different story, I find. And yet one inescapable truth for all but precious few of us is that a couple of generations from now, no one will know or remember or care that you even walked the earth. So given that reality, what matters? I have to come back to Rosalind Carter, that the bricks are straight. And yes, while I'm focusing on this brick in front of me, I have to pay attention to all the overwhelming problems that plague our world. But when it comes time for me to take my last breath, what will I say matters then? In my role as an oncology chaplain, I would say I'm sort of in the coming out business. I'm creating a safe space for people to come out to me, to tell me their truth, often their deepest truth, and often at the most critical time of their lives, at the end of it. But the way I see it, it's not only a coming out business, it's also a meaning-making business, because once that truth is out there on the table, how do we contain it? How do we hold it? How do we make sense of it all? That's part of the gift and exhilaration of doing this work. Every day I get that constant reminder, Michael, pay attention. Particularly as I move well into the third act of my life. When I reflect back on Acts 1 and 2, I realize how seldom it was that I was ever focused on the brick in front of me. I always had my eye around the corner to the next decision, the next choice. How does this one affect that one? Which class do I take? What do I major in? What career do I pursue? Which relationships do I nurture to get me closer to wherever it is I think I want to go? And in a way, that's still true, but perhaps with less urgency. But then again, maybe with even more urgency, because at this stage of my life, the big what's next for me is the home stretch, the final reckoning, as it were. So when it comes time for me to take my last breath, what will I say matters then? There are, of course, as many answers to that question as there are individuals on the planet. And yet I do hear some common themes expressed by folks who are facing that very question when deciding whether or not to sign up for guaranteed more suffering with the next chemo, the next drug trial, the next surgery, the next radiation. What is it that makes life worth fighting for? Well, I'd like to live long enough to see my son graduate high school or college, or to see my daughter get married. I'd like to see my grandchild be born. Still, I find those to be deceptively simple and tidy answers, not really revealing the larger picture, the whole truth. I remember many years ago, I was assigned to the inpatient bone marrow transplant unit at UCLA. Leukemia and lymphoma patients mostly, who often spent many weeks, if not months, in the hospital. And there I met Leon, who was a difficult, prickly, not at all likable guy. In all of his weeks in the hospital, I never saw that he had a single visitor. And he was sort of proud of that. I don't need anybody, he would say. He had his own business, and he had a dog who scared the neighbors. Leon identified as an atheist, a secular Jew, and he presumed I was religious and Christian, neither of which, of course, are true, but he used to enjoy duking it out with me, philosophically speaking. That was the nature of my spiritual care. We would engage in these deep theological discussions. Once he got his bone marrow transplant, however, things went south pretty quickly. And the doctors came in with that awful news, nothing more we can do. Well, then his heart began to soften up and the tears came. But the very next day, the docs came in and said, wait, there's one more drug trial we think you might qualify for. Oh, his spirits went through the roof, mine too. This is great news, Leon. Tell me, what are you going to do with more time if you get it? I eagerly wanted to know. I'd like to finish my invoicing, he said. My heart just sank in total disappointment, I admit, and judgment. I was not a good chaplain in that moment. I did not ask the next obvious question. Oh, that's interesting. Tell me why your invoice is so important to you. No, I just sat there in total judgment, really. I guess I was hoping he'd say, I'd like to walk my dog one more time on the beach, or I'd like to see one more beautiful sunset. I'd like to hear Rhapsody in Blue one more time. No, he said, I'd like to finish my invoicing. That's where he found his meaning. That's what mattered. Marianne was in her mid-40s. She had lived the previous several years with pancreatic cancer, and I walked the last few months of her journey by her side. I went to see her in the hospital not long before she died. She was hooked up to every kind of tube and pump and hose imaginable, absolutely cooked and fried. Michael, I'm just done. Ready for it to be over. But it wasn't an option because her husband and her kids, of course, wanted her to keep fighting. Try the next drug trial, the next chemo, try the next surgery, get a second opinion, a third opinion, a fifth opinion. I can't die, she said, having them think for the rest of their lives I didn't love them enough to keep fighting. Do you think that's what they're going to think of me? What do you want, Marianne, if you could call the shots right now? Oh, that's easy, she said. I would disconnect all of this. I'd ask my husband to get in bed with me and hold me and look out that window across the room at that tree across the street and say, look at that leaf on that tree fluttering in the breeze. Look at how it catches the sunlight. Isn't that beautiful? A God moment, she would call it. Over our months of conversation, she had told me about other God moments, moments that sort of anchored her into life, moments in which not much really happened, but the stuff and business of life just fell away, leaving room, space for an awareness of this moment being enough and being beautiful. I'd like one more God moment, she said. I met Evelyn on her first day of chemotherapy after having been newly diagnosed with ovarian cancer. She came to see me every couple of weeks for the next 6 years for a session. Though she never wanted to talk about anything of any more consequence, it seemed, than what she and her husband Gene had done the previous weekend. Despite all my invitation, holding the door open to talk about the other deeper themes and questions that are coming down the pike, she never took the bait. I didn't feel like I was doing much of anything as a chaplain, but she would always conclude each visit by thanking me. Oh, Michael, thank you so much. I always feel so much better after talking to you. I went to see her in the hospital the day before she died. She and her husband Gene were there, of course. They'd been married just forever. No kids, though. High school sweethearts. The Buddhists think it's a good idea to reflect on the sweet memories of life when one is about to make their transition as a way to maybe grease the wheels for the next incarnation. No matter what our beliefs are about such ideas, it's not a bad idea. So I asked Jean, tell me that story again about how you guys met. I love that story. And he launched into the story, and Evelyn soon enough got a little distressed. She didn't remember. Undaunted, Jean pressed on. Oh, sure you do, honey. Remember we went to that football game and we were in the back seat of the car? No. Now she was very irritated. The memory was gone. Forever. So Jean changes course and says, that's okay, honey. Maybe you're just tired. You want to rest. Tell you what, Michael and I will go out in the hall. We'll chat a little while, give you a chance to rest. How about that? No, she said defiantly. I want you both here. I just don't want anybody to talk. And so I sat on one edge of the bed, and Jean sat on the other edge of the bed, and we each held a hand. And we just sat there in silence, looking at each other. There's absolutely nothing to do, nothing to say, just holding this space of love. For the rest of my life, that scene has imprinted my heart of what truly sacred space looks like. Perhaps what matters most is what's left when everything that we thought had mattered has burnt away. So what matters to me now, today? This conversation matters. Kindness really matters. Friendship, love, of course, being a witness to one another in our lives, kinship, communion, an old-fashioned religious word, but I love it, the imagery of it, taking in and digesting our common humanity, our connection to each other, to nature, to the source of life, that matters. Sure, I'd like to think when I am breathing my last breath that I will be thinking I made a difference, that I relieved some suffering. Here and there I provided some encouragement. That I had a blast. That I saw the world. That I loved hard. But I'm not so delusional as to think it was ever anything more than one conversation at a time, one brick at a time. We go through our lives making countless choices, having countless contacts and conversations, a little encouragement, a little support here and there. Those encounters might have the farthest reaching impact of anything we ever do. They might, in fact, be our greatest legacy. Joseph Campbell says he believes it's important for us to realize the eternal within, that we are to participate with joy in the sorrows of the world. To participate with joy in the sorrows of the world. I come back to that again and again as a kind of mantra. I don't know. Maybe it just comes down to being moved by life. So be it.
This month we are sharing 50% of our offering with Camp de Benneville Pines. Camp de Benneville Pines is a camp in the San Bernardino Mountains that is used as a retreat by our congregation and by congregations throughout the Pacific Southwest District. For many years, our congregation has had an annual weekend retreat there, and many of our children have attended summer and winter camps. Many individuals from our congregation have attended other camps there, focusing on music, art, meditation, and identity. Because of COVID-19, De Benneville has not had income for months. Our own September retreat has been canceled, yet their expenses continue. Let us give our financial support to De Benneville Pines in hopes that they will be able to survive these difficult times and that we can all look forward to gathering together once again under the pines, in the mountain air, in the years to come. You can give with your smartphone. Text 844-982-0209 and put in the amount that you wish to donate in the body of the text, followed by the letters GCC. The first time you give in this way, it will ask you to set it up. After that, it will be simple. Again, the number is 844-982-0209. I'm also told that we have added a QR code to the donation page, which, if scanned with your smartphone camera, should take you to the website to make a donation there. This is all new technology for some of us, so don't worry if you don't get it the first time. The morning offering will now be gratefully accepted.
The promise of the Spirit, faith, hope, and love abide, and so every soul is blessed and made whole. The truth in our hearts is our guide. We are answering the call of love. Join together as hearts beat as one. Emboldened by faith, we dare to proclaim, we are answering the call of love. Sometimes we build a barrier to keep love tightly bound, corrupted by fear, unwilling to hear, denying the beauty we found. We are answering the call of love. Hands joined together as hearts beat as one. Emboldened by faith, we dare to proclaim, we are answering the call of love. A bright new day is dawning, when love will not divide. Reflections of grace in every embrace, fulfilling the vision divine. We are answering the call of love. hands join together as hearts beat as one. Emboldened by faith, we dare to proclaim we are answering the call of love. We are answering the call of love.
I invite you to perhaps close your eyes and take a few nice deep breaths together with me, breathing in the love, the intention, the commitment of this community to come together and to connect, despite all that there is now to separate us physically. As we exhale, can we release the light and the radiance of our coming together, not only back to one another, but to the larger circles of life? Let's even stretch our arms out right now, right where we are, right where you're sitting, and imagine our embrace of each other in those larger circles of life, getting a sense of our connectedness in a place beyond time and space, despite the physical isolation of this moment. As we breathe into that embrace, let's absorb the words of the poet Rilke as a blessing to ourselves. Be patient toward all that is unsolved in your heart. Try to love the questions themselves like locked rooms and like books written in a very foreign tongue. Do not seek the answers which cannot be given to you, because you would not be able to live them. Live the questions now. Perhaps you will then gradually, without noticing it, live along some distant day into the answer. So be it.